Hello, my name is Caitlin Gardner. I work on the intellectual property team at Jpmorgan. With me today is JF Lego. Can you introduce yourself?
JF Lego, I head up cybersecurity operations for the firm. So my job covers a wide variety of elements that all pertain to defending the firm. It ranges from understanding what criminals do on a day-to-day basis, what nation-state threat actors do on a day-to-day basis, and then looking at how we leverage this threat data to better protect the firm. So that will range from creating detection, mitigation, and response scenarios in light of the various threats and risks that we see, having teams that can carry out incident response and investigations if that were to happen, but also teams that can simulate adversary activity against our network to keep us always ready. So our red team that will simulate adversary activity hands on keyboard, so they'll be behaving just like a threat actor while attempting to breach our network, but also having individuals that create simulations, that create exercises that encompass both technology teams, cyber teams, and the business to see how we would react in one of those scenarios that would range from a massive outage across the financial sector to anything that impacts the firm from a cyber standpoint. And then you have assessments team that carry out testing of our applications and our infrastructure to find vulnerabilities that we would then go out and remediate. So their job is twofold: discovering vulnerabilities in the environment, collecting information on vulnerabilities that exist in various products and technologies, and ensuring that we're remediating that on a timely basis to keep the firm safe.
And what do you see in your role today as some of the biggest risks in cybersecurity today?
You know, when you break down the risk, they fall into three broad categories: confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So confidentiality is, you know, your data breach. So data being exposed to individuals that should not have access to it. And some of it could be a breach by a nation state actor who's trying to get information as part of, you know, their country's programs or how they can leverage that to drive industry. It could also be a criminal actor looking to get access to personal information or account information that they can then leverage to commit fraud. When you look at integrity, some of that could be criminals looking to compromise a network to initiate payments on fraudulent payments to bad beneficiaries, from which they can actually then take the money and move it to somebody's else's account to launder the funds. And then availability. I think availability has gotten a lot more attention recently with ransomware attacks, whereby companies are being targeted by various criminal groups that are heavily focused on taking control of the network to deploy ransomware to stop the operations, and, as the name implies, request a ransom to allow the company to continue its operations. So really, we're seeing a broad variety of threats, and it's our job to assess those threats and how they impact us, but also how they impact our clients and customers. So a lot of what we do on my team as well is to look at the various threats that target different industries in which our clients operate, threats that target consumers, and see how we can help mitigate that working with our partners in the various businesses.
So how would you say our customers can protect themselves given some of the threats in cybersecurity and across the industry?
That's a really good question. I'll break it down into two different areas. So you have our customers, our retail customers, the consumers, and then you have our corporate clients, and they face different threats, right? So when you look at consumers, a lot of that has to do with identity theft. A lot of it has to do with fraud. So what you would want in a circumstance like that is to protect your credit, so freeze your credit or have credit monitoring in place. Use what's called multi-factor authentication. Either you're getting a text message or you have an app on your phone that allows you to validate your access, so a second set of credentials. And then it's being very careful on your behavior, so not clicking on links, being very conscious of spam and phishing emails and malware, and keeping the software on your computer patched and up to date. Now, if you look at our commercial clients, they're often targeted by what we call business email compromise or vendor email compromise, meaning somebody in their organization that has the ability to move money will be targeted by criminal groups saying, we need you to make this payment urgently. It used to be that we would see those types of emails saying, you know, we need you to move $2-3 million extremely quickly to a country outside of their normal geography of where they operate. And those messages would come from the CEO, the CFO, the treasurer of the organization. Now, I think criminals have wisened up because those were large sums of money that were outside of the normal business processes, and through education and working with our clients, I think, you know, a lot of companies have rolled out controls over that. So now what we're seeing is what's called vendor email compromise. So these are frauds where the criminals are sending emails that look to be coming from a vendor, and they're changing the payment instructions. So they'll change the payment instruction from the current account that they use to another account that's under their control, and they'll ask the company to send funds to that account. What gets interesting there is that oftentimes it's a delayed discovery, because if I'm a criminal and I send you that email, you know, at the middle of the month, and I say, please change those payment instructions, and then at the end of the month I make that payment, it might take a while before it gets discovered that it was fraud. When the vendor does the reconciliation, there's a late payment, and then the money's gone. So having strong controls over disbursements and making sure that there's validation in place and there's out-of-band validation of any changes to beneficiaries proves to be a pretty effective control with that. And I mentioned ransomware. Ransomware is a significant attack. So having strong controls over malware, reminding employees not to click on emails becomes an important approach. So it really comes back in a lot of cases to awareness, right? So people are your first line of defense. They can actually spot things that look anomalous, whether it be an email or any type of behavior. And then, you know, looking at how you keep them focused on the issue. So there's, you know, how do you build visual cues into email software that tells them the message is external? How do you run phishing tests to keep them sharp and looking for messages that are of concern, right? So how do you actually educate people in the different circumstances that pertain to their daily lives? And by doing that, I think we have employees that are more aware of risk when they come to work. So they're less likely to click on links. They're more likely to report suspicious emails, and vice versa. They actually take that home and protect themselves at home and protect their families at home.
Can you talk a little bit about how innovation plays a part into cybersecurity and how we can use advancements in technology to further protect our customers and our clients?
You know, I think where we're lucky here at Jpmorgan is that we have a very strong program around innovation and intellectual property management, and that fosters that creativeness. I look at my team and I'm always challenging them to solve problems differently, and I think having their name on a patent is kind of a reward for them because they've created something new, and that drives that innovation. So where do we look at innovations? Like, what new sources of data can we leverage, and how do we leverage that data to do detection? How are we creating new methods of analysis to find adversary activity? So there's a number of opportunities that we have with technology innovation, but that also working with technology partners. So our vendors and different companies that have new ideas, and partnering with them to understand, you know, what can be done differently and what our different challenges are.
So you are designated as a prolific inventor at Jpmorgan
Yes.
Chase. Can you talk a little bit about some of the work that you did on a few of the patents that you are listed as an inventor on?
Yeah. So, you know, it goes back to some of the new challenges that we're seeing. Business email compromise was a big one that we were seeing in 2014, 2015, 2016. in terms of fraud. And we had to come up with different ways of analyzing data and looking at transactions. Historically wasn't done in commercial products, and bringing that together and partnering with our lines of business that service commercial clients and getting the thought process going with them as to, hey, what are the challenges? Why are we seeing this? What controls can we improve on? So looking at the efficacy of the control and seeing where do we want to get to in terms of the efficacy, and then be able to go and create new detection methods that allowed us to integrate transactional data with cyber data to make decisions on payments that would allow us to detect fraud earlier on in the process, right? And say, we're gonna start blocking those transactions before they actually occur or as they're occurring, not once the money's gone. So that was the motivation of getting earlier in that attack chain, and that's what fostered the innovation.
Right, early detection and response is definitely important in that context. So you talked a little bit about partnership in the ecosystem. How is Jpmorgan approaching partnership within vendors and also other financial institutions?
So that's a really important point. The partnership that exists amongst financial institutions and the level of collaboration is key, right, to protecting the sector. We couldn't protect the sector, the financial sector, and a variety of other industries that revolve around it if there wasn't information sharing, if there wasn't close collaboration. So there are conferences for financial institutions where there's a lot of information sharing going on. JPMC participated in the creation of the Financial Systemic Analysis and Resilience Center, which brought together the 8 large banks in the U.S. to drive collaboration on information sharing, but also on risk management. And that has driven sectorial exercises where the banks get together to assess how we as a sector would respond to a variety of attacks. And that just continues to make us better because we learn from our peers, right? There really isn't any competitive angle when the cybersecurity teams get together. It's really about information sharing, talking about threats, talking about controls that we've tested that are effective, and then get together and then bring that back into our organizations to help improve how we're defending the organization. So when you came to meet with my team, you left them with 2 big takeaways when it comes to intellectual property management. What were they?
So I think first, the importance of innovation in everyday responsibilities in cybersecurity and across all industries. And thinking about it within a cyber context helps us to frame new ideas and also think about ways that we can be more aware of what our adversaries might be doing, but also promotes innovation internally, thinking outside of the box, using design thinking, and helping move the needle towards patent and also trade secret awareness. I think the second thing is protecting proprietary information and awareness around confidentiality. So helping our employees understand the importance of protecting confidential information and making sure that those techniques for how to approach those situations or where they may be exposed and helping them have the resources for who to reach out to is extremely important.
And you bring up a really, really good point, right? My past life was in consulting, and a lot of the work that I did was assisting organizations that had an intellectual property breach. So an employee stealing source code, employees stealing trade secrets, and recovering it is a lot more costly than protecting it. Because you can imagine you have to go through the court system, you have to prevent the person from subsequently using it. So there's a number of steps. And that's really why the message resonates with me and my team is when you came in and you started talking about that protection, I had seen the flip side of that where, you know, I was working with companies where an employee, and I remember one of these, the employee had stolen their entire trading algorithms, right? This is a long time ago. Trading algorithms were like something brand new, and an employee had stolen all that information and was building a startup off of it. And when you look at the work that the company had to put in to prevent this former employee from using that information, that was really significant. So, you know, when you start seeing a lot of the work that we do in cybersecurity, which is protecting our clients' and customers' information, it's also essential that we consider protecting intellectual property, because that's a key asset to organizations.
Absolutely. And I think with the increased number of threats in cybersecurity today, and the U.S. Defend Trade Secrets Act that's come out, and there's really an increased pressure on companies now to carry out control measures to make sure that employees are aware of trade secret information, and that companies take reasonable steps to address those concerns with trade secrets and confidential information in the industry today. Thank you.